So the first Pirates of the Caribbean movie was really good, and that's what makes this so painful. The fifth one just came out. It's called Dead Men Tell No Tales, and I saw it, and it's very bad. Spoilers, by the way. It's very bad. This is kind of a review of that movie, but also kind of a breakdown of why the Pirates movies keep getting worse and worse. Or like why they got abruptly worse and then stayed worse. Since this is the fifth Pirates movie, I have come up with five reasons. Number one, Jack Sparrow is not fun anymore. This is the biggest problem, and hopefully what's gonna put the series out of its misery once and for all. Basically, the whole success of these movies hinges entirely on Jack Sparrow, and it always has. In the first movie, it was this crazy, weird performance of a pirate character. He was cool and clever and unpredictable and like a bad guy with a heart of gold. Like, Johnny Depp actually deserves serious props for getting this script of a pretty straightforward but cool pirate character and portraying him in this really weird original way where he's like a rock star. Jack Sparrow, as we know it, wouldn't exist without Johnny Depp. Unfortunately, Jack Sparrow hasn't really worked since the first movie. The thing is, in the first movie, Jack Sparrow wasn't written as a crazy rock star. He was just written as a cool pirate, and then Johnny Depp brought the rest to the table. When they wrote the sequel, they weren't thinking, okay, let's write some more of this cool pirate character. They were thinking, people liked Jack Sparrow, let's do more of that. Hey, they liked when he talked about the rum being gone. Let's put that joke in again. Does he have a catchphrase? Make sure and put his catchphrase in there. Write a situation into the script where he can make silly faces. We need lots more silly faces, like a scene where he's like losing his balance on a big moving set piece and he goes, and to indicate that he's losing his balance. Hey, what if we had a scene with 20 Jack Sparrows? People like one Jack Sparrow. They're gonna like a lot of him. People said they like Jack Sparrow, right? This is all that I know how to do. I am useless. And now for this movie, we have like a serious problem. Jack Sparrow is a lovable rogue. He's arrogant, constantly drunk, womanizing, violent, but it feels kind of cheeky and self-aware. He's a pirate with a heart of gold, remember? Pirates 5 starts out like, oh, look, it's Jack Sparrow. He's drunk. It's just morning, but he's drunk already. The thing is now, when I see his drunk antics, I'm kind of like, oh,
Have you
wow.
drunk this whole thing this morning?
That feels familiar. Not in a good way. Oh, why is the rum gone? That reminds me of that video of Johnny Depp drinking an entire bottle of wine in the morning and then yelling at his wife. And all of that aside, the biggest problem with Jack Sparrow is that they failed to use him sparingly. Use him sparrowingly. I'm gonna say that. He worked well as a secondary character. Part of what made him cool in the first movie is that he kept you guessing. Like, he always seemed like he was one step ahead. His motives were kind of unclear. He would just randomly betray whoever's side he was on to serve his own mysterious purposes. And like, sometimes it would turn out he was helping the good guys, and it's back to that heart of gold core. Hey, maybe he's a good guy too. Oh, wait. He's doing something tricky again. He's a loose cannon. How exciting. If he's the main character, the audience kind of needs to know his motives, or else they don't know what the scene is doing or who to root for. And a main character can't really be one step ahead all the time, or else there's no conflict or tension. So instead of seeming like this clever, genius pirate, he turns into like a bumbling slapstick buffoon, and he still switches allegiances, but it just kind of seems like he's doing it randomly, like for no reason. Like he doesn't have a plan and just kind of doesn't know what's going on either. Usually they reconcile this idea by explaining that in this movie, we're seeing a new, down on his luck Jack Sparrow. He's drunker and poorer and like a shell of his former self or something. Boy. That sounds fun to watch. And like in the very first movie, we're introduced to him when he's down on his luck. He sails into port on a ship that's like all the way sunk, and he has no crew and no money, and it doesn't seem to bother him because he's the man with the plan. And that's part of what makes him initially interesting. At some point, they took this devil may care confidence and just transformed it into like the worst of all of his traits. He doesn't care about anything, but it's in like that lazy stoner way where he can't get anything done. At the beginning of this movie, he messes up a bank robbery for his crew because he just straight up falls asleep. He wants a bottle of rum and he has no money, so he trades away a powerful magical object that he knows is important. So the franchise still hangs on Jack Sparrow, but now he's like a lame, stupid, drunken idiot. Number two, the dull, boring love story. Since Will Turner and Elizabeth Swann ended their story in number three, the filmmakers have kind of struggled with how they're gonna have some kind of love story in the movies. I don't really get why this is necessary, but it is nice to have girl characters in the movies, and they're pretty much only going to do that if they're either a love interest or like a weird voodoo priestess witch character with no personality. So like, yeah, I'll take what I can get. In number four, they tried to give Jack Sparrow a love interest, which was like a terrible idea and didn't work at all. You don't believe that Jack Sparrow is going to settle down with a nice lady, or that he'd even want to. But maybe they knew this because they also wrote in a sexy Christian missionary and a mermaid to fall in love with each other. They were kind of the bright-eyed replacements for Will and Elizabeth, and their storyline was also left kind of open-ended, so you could bring them back if you wanted to, but nobody liked or remembered those characters, so I assume we're never gonna see them again. In this movie, they didn't try to give Jack Sparrow a love story, which, like, good. They learned their lesson, but instead they basically just recycled their trick from number four, where they wrote in another pairing of bland, attractive secondary characters to fall in love with each other. Will Turner and Elizabeth Swann weren't crazy interesting, but like you knew where they were coming from. When you came into the movie, Will was already interested in Elizabeth because he had known her for years and she was this attractive lady of higher status who was nice to him. Then Elizabeth fell for Will over the course of the movie when she saw the lengths he was willing to go to rescue her, and also he became like a cool, rebellious, but still nice pirate who looked like Orlando Bloom. They weren't like the most exciting characters, but you could at least root for them. They were just good, nice people who kind of earnestly pined for each other. It looks like in this movie, some writer said that love stories are more interesting if the leads hate each other and fight the whole time, because fighting equals passion, and you don't have to develop the characters beyond that. So we have Henry and Karina. Henry is Will and Elizabeth's son, and like, kudos to casting, because he really does look a lot like Orlando Bloom to me. But I also really have trouble telling good-looking people apart. I spent like 4 years thinking every leading man looks like James Franco. And we also have Karina, and she's an astronomer, and she's sassy. Henry and Karina are both good, nice people who save each other's lives and share a common goal. For some reason, once the movie puts them together on a boat, it decides that they need to constantly snark and bicker with each other. Like they have to snipe and be sarcastic and pretend they aren't concerned about each other's well-being for some reason. And they don't really tell you why. I mean, like, these are the olden days. You can marry someone after like a week. There's no shame in catching feelings. They have no reason to hate each other, and their bickering isn't witty enough to be interesting to watch. I actually liked both these actors. I thought they did fine. They just didn't really have anything to do. And they get together at the end and it's just like, okay, there's nothing there. Number three. The comedy is bad, 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 so bad. One really weird thing in this movie is that they had to repeat every joke twice. They had some joke where Henry catches Karina from below to stop her from dying by hanging, and she says that his hand is on her stern because it's like a silly boat pun for touching her butt. That's the whole joke. And then for some reason, she says it again. Like, a couple lines later. Like, they were worried you didn't hear it, because it's so clever. They also had this physical comedy gag where Jack Sparrow's gonna get beheaded by a guillotine, and then the platform he's on flips upside down, and while it's flipping around and around, the blade keeps sliding closer to his neck, and then farther away. Kind of a dumb, unbelievable action sequence, but I guess that's a clever concept. And then he stops spinning, and there's like a couple seconds of pause, and then he gets hit again, and starts spinning again, and they establish again that the blade is moving closer and farther away and that it's funny, and they even use the same camera angle, and you're like, did they think I fell asleep for a second? They had Johnny Depp say that instead of a guillotine, he'd rather be stoned, and it's like a joke, like stoned like weed. Get it, you guys? Pirates. He's smoking weed. And then later in the same scene, I think when he's flipping around on the guillotine for the second time, he says again that he'd rather be stoned. Nope, get it? Did you laugh the first time? It's back. They had Karina say she's a horologist, and the joke is that the pirates think that she said she's a whore. And they have all these puns, and they literally milk this joke for like 5 minutes, like it's the Who's on First scene or something. And you're just sitting there the whole time like, oh my god, I get it, okay. So as you might have noticed, it really doesn't help that all the jokes in this movie sucked and were not funny the first time. One excellent example of the film's badness is the Paul McCartney cameo. I have nothing against Paul McCartney. When I heard he had a cameo in this movie, I was like, what? But they already did that joke where Keith Richards was a pirate. They're gonna have another rock star be a pirate? Isn't that just the same joke? Well, I'll have to keep an eye out for Paul McCartney so I don't miss his cameo. I did not need to worry about that. The movie like stops dead for several minutes so Jack Sparrow can have a conversation with his uncle Paul McCartney. And just the whole point of the scene is like, oh look, it's Paul McCartney. If you didn't know who Paul McCartney is, like if you were a little kid that this movie was made for, you'd be like, what was that scene? Why did that happen? In the scene that leads up to this, Jack is getting dragged to his execution by two guards. So like there's one of them holding each of his arms and they're like physically dragging him. And then he sees Paul McCartney in the jail cell and he like drags the guards over so he can be close to the bars and talk to Paul McCartney. This idea would maybe work for like a couple lines of dialogue, but the scene just goes on and on forever. And the guards are just awkwardly standing there. Like, they forgot that they were taking him someplace. It was really obvious that they spent, like, 9 hours getting Paul McCartney into this elaborate pirate makeup and then had, like, a full day of shooting where he was on set and they, like, ad-libbed for a long time. And they probably got a lot of stuff that seemed funny if you were there. And then they were like, well, you can't cut it out. It's Paul McCartney. So instead, you just have this weird, awkward conversation in the middle of a time in the story when something's kind of happening. And I'm like, why are these guards being so patient? And they do that stupid comedy device thing where they frame the shot so you can't see the guards' faces. You can just see their hands on his shoulders because the movie's hoping you'll forget that they're human beings that are standing near Jack Sparrow. I hate when comedy movies do this. It never works. You never forget. And also the scene just isn't funny or good or worth it. Number four, the pirate mythology magic doesn't work anymore. I think it's a great idea to add mysticism to your pirate universe because like sailors are very superstitious folk and there are a lot of famous pirate legends that you can work in. So cursed treasure. Perfect sense. And the idea of the crew that turns into skeleton pirates is like a really clever way of working in that part from the theme park attraction where you see skeleton pirates. Mermaids it would have been okay with if you just saw like a little bit of a mermaid instead of like these CGI demon things that are just in full view. Davy Jones in the second movie is also a really cool addition because Davy Jones is like one of the most famous superstitious ocean things. It's kind of weird that he has an octopus face though. Like it is a really cool and clever idea and stuff. It's just that like these films have kind of a look to them that I don't know if this CGI octopus face man really gels with. A Kraken's okay, I guess. Sea monsters are very old school pirate mythology. But the idea of physically sailing a ship to the land of the dead to bring dead characters all the way back to life, a weird voodoo witch lady who can grow to be 20 feet tall, keeping ships in bottles so they're really tiny, but then if you throw them, they're a big size ship again and they just grow in front of us with CGI. It's so weird that they let it get so convoluted so fast. When I saw movie number four, it's like, it wasn't that good, but I was like, oh good, they get it. They get that it's just gotta be an episodic treasure hunt adventure. Mystic thing they gotta get. But if each quest has to be about a separate, new, super powerful magical object, then things are gonna start running into each other really fast. You know the animated Disney movie Aladdin? Well, it had these direct-to-video sequels that I loved when I was a kid. They weren't very good. The third movie's a treasure hunt movie, and everyone's trying to get the Hand of Midas, and it's just this gold hand. And if you touch it onto something, it turns that thing into gold. So this is a magical object. You could kill someone with it, so it's kind of scary, kind of powerful, but it's not like universe-breaking powerful. That's a good thing to have your characters looking for. Everyone's fighting over it because it can make you really rich, but it's not like so overpowered that it changes the rules of your entire universe. In the fourth movie, the Holy Grail and the Fountain of Youth exist, so you can live forever. In the third movie, they establish that you can just sail to the land of the dead and just bring back whatever dead person you feel like. In this movie, Captain Barbossa has like a witch lady that he keeps on shore in some kind of crown-sponsored witch kennel. I really thought this was something from another movie that I was forgetting, and I asked a couple people and either they also forgot, which is bad, or she wasn't in any of the other movies, which is also bad. Why does he keep her there? Where did they meet? Is she okay with this? So now in this movie, they have to get Poseidon's trident to break all the curses of the sea. The concept is appealing to me because it implies that they're kind of trying to like just wipe the slate clean and get rid of all this random magic stuff they made so far. But like, wait, does this mean that the Greek god Poseidon existed in this universe? Are the other Greek gods real too? Wait, didn't the voodoo lady grow to be 20 feet tall because it turned out she was a goddess of the sea also? How many are there in the Pirates canon? So gods are real and they coexist in this universe with comedy pirate Paul McCartney and CGI octopus face man. Is Poseidon gonna be the bad guy in the sixth movie? Is Jack Sparrow gonna ascend to godhood and fight him? Will he be giant when he does that? Okay, number five is a spoiler. I assume nobody cares. And it is a big one, but number five is they killed Captain Barbossa. He's only my favorite character, it's fine. Barbossa is so underrated because he's literally the pirate element of the Pirates movies. He's the best character in all of them. He's ruthless, but he's nuanced and human. The performance is great. He has really good dialogue. He has like some good monologues in the first movie. He's like a crazy evil pirate, but also a gentleman who operates with a code of honor. He's like an old school pirate. He's like Captain Hook or Long John Silver or something. Jack Sparrow was like an original character portrayal where he's like a rock star, but Barbossa was a pirate. He was a pirate's pirate. The only good moment in the second movie is when they're in the voodoo lady's house at the very end of the movie. Suddenly, Barbossa comes down the stairs. He's alive. He takes a big bite of the apple. Even though it doesn't really make sense and it raises some weird questions like, why did she bring him back? Do they know each other? Has he been just living in her house the whole time? Like awkward roommates? And he followed my old favorite villain arc of like being defeated in the first installment and then awkwardly becoming friends with the heroes. But then in this movie, they revealed in the third act that the hot romantic lead woman is his daughter. And then in a final act of heroism, he dies to save her. And granted, it was one of the coolest deaths they could have given him. He literally impaled a guy with a sword and then flung both of his arms out and fell backwards into the crushing waves in slow motion for this like really long 30-second shot while he's just staring dead at the camera like, I literally don't care this is happening. I assume they wrote him out because the actor's like not a young guy and he's probably getting tired of jumping around in front of green screens, so they decided to just give him a dignified exit. But like, come on man, if you kill Barbossa, what's even the point of these movies anymore? This character death also points a spotlight on one of my previous issues, which is that nothing that happens in the story even matters at this point. Like I said, there's just too much magic. Like, they already brought this guy back from the dead already. They think we just forgot? It's like a comic book. They could just write him back in at any moment if they felt like it. He came back to life. Jack Sparrow came back to life. Then we have a huge assortment of characters that died and came back as zombies or ghosts or something. Bootstrap Bill, Captain Salazar, even Will Turner died for a second. There are no stakes and nothing means anything. Yay! Actually, this entire series would be 100% redeemed for me if they just made Pirate 6 and then unabashedly end it with the exact same scene where they're like in a cabin, Barbossa comes down the stairs, he's alive, he eats an apple. So that's everything. Yarr. I got through the whole thing without making a pun about how the title talks about men who can't tell tales. Okay, this also made me mad, speaking of the title. Did you notice that they messed up the title drop? So usually in pirate lore, Dead Men Tell No Tales equals if you need a secret to be kept, like maybe where a treasure is, you gotta kill everyone else that knows it, because Dead Men Tell No Tales. So this movie had like a clever inversion of that, where they have Captain Salazar, the anti-pirate, and he kills entire shipfuls of men, but then he keeps one alive because he wants them to tell the tale, because he wants everyone to be afraid of him. And they half have him explain it that way, like they lead into it, but then instead of ending it there, they have him like keep talking for a really long time, and then finally he's like, hey, if you see Jack Sparrow, tell him I'm looking for him. I'd tell him myself, but dead men tell no tales. And then they drop the title card and stuff. But that meaning doesn't make sense for Dead Men Tell No Tales. Like, wait, what? That's not a tale. It's just a message. And you, personally, are an undead man, fully capable of telling tales. Like, you had this teed up and you totally missed it. It's so embarrassing.